We have with us here in Virginia Beach CBN News senior editor John Waghi. And joining us from Washington is our CBN terrorism analyst, Eric Stackelback. Eric, let's begin with you. First, the events along Israel's northern border. A ceasefire ended the war between Israel and Hezbollah back in 2006. But after this week's incidents, do you see the conflict getting bigger?
I do, Ephraim. You know, this has been a long time coming. As you said, the last time there were major hostilities between Israel and Hezbollah was back in the summer of 2006. Now, we've seen several small-scale wars between Israel and Hamas to the south in the past few years. But finally, Ephraim, the north is heating up, apparently. Look, in the past month, we saw the leader of Hezbollah, Sheikh Hassan Nasrallah, basically say that in the next conflict, Hezbollah was going to cross into Israel and invade the Galilee region of Israel where Jesus once walked. So that's number one. Number two, last week, the Israelis took out a convoy of Hezbollah and Iranian operatives on the Syrian side of the Golan Heights, right along Syria's border with Israel. Number three, we had this latest terror attack by Hezbollah against Israeli soldiers this morning. Two Israeli soldiers apparently dead, several more wounded. So what we're seeing right now is a ratcheting up of hostilities without a doubt. And it's only a matter of time, Ephraim, before Israel and Hezbollah, I believe, engage again in really an all-out war. And I think this will be the war, I guess, to settle the score, if you will, because I think this time Israel will not hold back anything. I think the goal in the next major conflict will be for Israel to decisively crush Hezbollah.
All right, Eric, let's turn to the White House now. Some eyebrows were raised when the president changed his plans to go pay his respect to the new Saudi king, yet he had no time to honor the victims in Paris and, of course, did not attend the Holocaust victim services in Poland. Your reaction to that?
Well, I think, number one, I won't mince words about this, Ephraim. I think the apparent disregard of the administration for that anti-terror rally in Paris was an embarrassment. Look, the United States, the president of the United States, we are the leaders of the free world. And for us not to be there, not to even send a high-ranking administration official, at least the vice president or the secretary of state, for me spoke volumes about where this administration stands in this global existential struggle against radical Islam and jihad. The same with not commemorating the Holocaust yesterday in a serious way, perhaps going to Auschwitz. But on the other hand, making your way to Saudi Arabia. And look, I get it, Ephraim. Administration after administration, Republican and Democrat, have catered to the Saudis. Unfortunately, George W. Bush did the same thing, had a very close relationship with the Saudi government. Here's why that's so problematic. Saudi Arabia has done more than anyone in the world to spread radical Islam around the globe. Ephraim, over the past few decades, the Saudis have spent billions of dollars in that oil money to build radical mosques and schools throughout Europe and the United States. Saudi Arabia, at the end of the day, is not a friend. Yes, we have similar enemies right now in ISIS and Iran and Hezbollah, but at the end of the day, let's remember, the Saudi regime is a radical Islamic regime which has funded jihad around the world. And may I add, 15 of the 19 9/11 hijackers hailed from Saudi Arabia and were weaned on that Saudi Wahhabism from a young age.
All right. Well, John, let's bring you in the conversation here. Prime Minister Netanyahu's opponents in Israel say that he's playing politics before the elections by coming to address a joint session of Congress here in the U.S. Do you think that's going to create backlash against him?
Well, it's funny, Ephraim. His opponents are shocked that they would play politics like this. Look, there's politics being played on both sides, but politics aren't the chief issue. And in fairness to Netanyahu, give him credit for the last 12 to 15 years spreading the word about Iran's danger to the world, not just Israel, about the nuclear weapons. So the fact that he's invited when some Republicans and Democrats in Congress are very, very concerned that the White House could reach a bad deal with Iran and allow them to get nuclear weapons ultimately, I think that Netanyahu can handle the political backlash that may be arising in his country right now. And also, politics is a lifetime. In Israel, like a few weeks, the elections are March 17th, so that's a lifetime between now and then. Netanyahu is down a bit in the polls now. His opponents are mobilizing and unifying. The Arabs have created a united bloc to run against him for the first time ever. And so he does have some opponents that are making headway, but several weeks, that that can change around 180. It's possible.
Speaking of elections, there, the White House says it's going to stay out. But there are now reports that Obama campaign people are organizing opposition to Netanyahu. Your thoughts on that?
Well, yeah, they want to be above the fray, and it's the Republicans in Congress who are playing politics with it. But in reality, there is a man, a young man, who ran Obama's South Carolina effort in 2008 when it was dead even between Obama and Hillary, and he ran the ground game, the ground organization for the Obama campaign. He's now gone to Israel and is organizing door-to-door, you know, kind of vote-getting capacity. And this is according to the leftist newspaper Haaretz, the Daily in Israel. So there is politics being played on that side. And make no mistake, they would love to oust Netanyahu. They say it's like we would like to bring a change and everything, but the administration would love to see him gone. Europe would love to see him gone. The left in Israel would love to see him gone. And that's what this is about. Not necessarily trying to defeat Likud, but trying to get Netanyahu out of the prime minister's office.
He is a strong man indeed. Eric, we know that Jordan agreed to a prisoner exchange with ISIS. Jordan is supposed to be a close U.S. ally. How serious is this?
Well, Jordan is an ally for sure, Ephraim, in the struggle against the jihad. ISIS has Jordan in its crosshairs, but this is part and parcel for what we've seen from many of our allies in this war. They don't share our view, Ephraim, in terms of hostage exchanges and not negotiating with terrorists. Actually, that view has apparently changed under the Obama administration. We now do negotiate with terrorists here in the U.S., but Europe and countries like Jordan, look, they will do hostage exchange. ISIS has made hundreds of millions of dollars, for instance, Ephraim, from Europe. European governments are willing to buck up and pay ISIS to get their hostages back. So I think we're seeing that again here in Jordan. Again, a different philosophy in many ways than we here in the United States have. Although Jordan is going to do this exchange, apparently, they still are very, very threatened by ISIS. That does not change, but unfortunately, these other governments have different philosophies on dealing with terrorists, and they are very willing to cut a deal. And they're going to, by the way, going to release a female jihadist, Wilda Jordanians, who was involved in an attack in Jordan years ago. So, you know, blood on her hands, to say the least. But this is the price Jordan is willing to pay.
Well, we'll keep an eye on it. Thank you both, Eric Stackelbeck and John Wagge. Appreciate both of your time.